Parents strongly caution the following programs are intended for mature audiences over the age of 18. These programs may contain some material that many parents would not find suitable for children and may include intense violence, sexual situations, coarse language, and suggestive dialogue.
Gonna pussyfoot around, ladies and gentlemen. Why beat around the bush unless you have to? Unless you're paying for it. And right now I'm here to tell you that I am not paying for it, frankly. I get it for free. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, where do we begin? Isn't it weird I try to make a quick little witty intro in order to get to the real intro?
I was just thinking, I have no idea what exactly it was you were saying.
I don't know.
Did I miss something, or is he really just babbling?
I'm literally babbling.
You're babbling.
I like to go from the cohesiveness of the children's show into the cohesiveness of the PSAs and our introductory music, and then just nail them with craziness, chaos, disorder,
phones are
explosion,
already ringing,
explosion
more,
of crazy.
More chaos.
There's no sense. Nothing makes any sense. I can't even understand it. Is this in a foreign language? Never mind a foreign language. Maybe an alien language. Because you know what it is? It's like it's not even a language at that point.
Right.
It's just so above me as a listener. You know, it's above me. That Paul Hullabaloo, he just is talking. I can't even understand him. It's above me.
Mm-hmm.
He is like a sonic boom of intellectual activity and intelligence. And I, what am I?
You are literally above me right now.
I'm a plebe. What's a plebe?
Plebe? Like a peasant?
Bill, is that a word?
A peasant?
Bill, yes, go ahead.
It's short for plebeian.
A plebeian, correct.
And a plebeian?
Now, a plebeian is what? Oh, the commoners.
The peasants.
It is funny that here I am, Paul Hullabaloo, on the microphone, a king of men and Jews, and then over in this corner you have the plebes and the peasants listening in the basements.
Yes.
Just hanging on my every nonsensical word.
Right.
Hanging.
Right.
Hanging by nooses
that
I have woven for them.
Shut it off!
That's right. What's up? Welcome to No Positive Radio. Now that I've turned off 90% of you and you have your radios off, that's the best thing, though. I guarantee nobody's turned off their radio. So, you know, turn your radio up a little bit. If you're on, what, a 4, turn it to a 6. Do regular radios, no, they don't really have knobs with numbers anyway. That's like an amp.
No.
A little water today?
How's that water?
You know, it's better when it's freezing cold. It's had a moment to sit, to ruminate, to chill, but not chill as in get cold.
Yeah.
To chill, dog. So anyway, welcome to the show. It's No Positive Radio. My name, as always, is Paul Hullabaloo, sitting directly in front of me, my minister of all that is electronically motivated. His name is...
Dirty John Winterbottom.
That's right, his name is Johnny.
Dirty Johnny.
Yes.
Gotta remember, my name is Dirty John
Winterbottom. I was about to say, because some of you may have... opened up the Providence Phoenix this week, you know, just casually flipping through to see what asinine, pathetic bands are playing that are not the Cringe.
Nice segue, by the way.
And you may have seen the fact that there was a, not just a little blurb.
No.
But a feature goddamn article about this very radio show in this week's edition of the Providence Phoenix.
Go grab it.
Very bizarre.
Grab it while it's hot. We're in there.
The article was written by Bob Gula.
Yes.
Bob Gula, the local columnist, the local kind of editorial columnist for the Phoenix. He writes a section called Local Anesthesia. And it's interesting because I've read his section. I've read his column probably since I lived in Rhode Island. I like it because, you know, as opposed to a lot of national acts and getting covered, that type of coverage, I kind of like seeing what's going on in my local area. Yeah. I like seeing what's a brewing around here.
What's a brewing?
And Bob Gula, I will sit here for a couple of seconds, blow a little bit of smoke up his
Why
ass.
Not?
Bob Gula is the guy, I would say the guy in this area that covers, you know, like what's the haps.
Right, right.
In, you know, Rhode Island, Providence, mm-hmm. that type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So to be included, not just a mention or a little this or a little of that, but to have a well-crafted and intelligent and editorially based article on No Positive Radio and John Winterbottom and myself, Paul Hullabaloo. You were listed as John Winterbottom.
Yes, both times they mentioned me in the paper. They decided just not to put Dirty
they
John.
They didn't like Dirty.
I don't know what was wrong with that. I don't know who I was offending, but...
I think they assumed that was misrepresented.
Yeah, maybe they thought it was a joke.
They probably thought that I had slipped that in to screw with you, which wouldn't be unusual.
I prefer Dirty John. I don't like just being called John. Sounds like my grandfather, who was John Winterbottom.
Really? Oh, yeah, that's right. Of course.
I'm technically a third, but I don't like adding that.
An old radio personality in his own right.
Yes, way back in the day.
Or I should say a gadio personality. I said it!
And, you know, you can also see the article online if you go to the providencephoenix.com.
Our website.
Or go to our website, and there's a link there, too.
NoPositiveRadio.fanspace.com. There's a lot of interesting
We've actually there. Updated the website, folks.
Yeah, it's back on in order here.
We're going to pay a little more attention to it now.
That's NoPositiveRadio.fanspace.com. Now, I was thinking about it. Here we are. It was last Monday. I did about a 45-minute-long interview over the phone with Bob Gula.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to tell you, I've done a few interviews in my life, mostly in Europe when we were in the hardcore scene in West Germany and Holland. We did a couple of interviews.
Yes.
Essentially, it's an interesting thing because think of you know, if you break it down, you think of what it is. When you're having a conversation with somebody, what's really important is the kind of the, you know, ideology of what you're discussing with somebody. You know, the rhetoric, the discourse. That's what's important. More so than the actual sentence structure or the way you're saying something. You just are trying to communicate an idea, communicate a thought to somebody. Now you're in an interview. Suddenly, you know, everything is completely different. You know, seeing your own words written down and not by your own hand is a very powerful and strange concept. And giving somebody a bunch of essentially sound bites of your ideas, little tiny collections of your ideas to take on their own terms and create and, you know, fashion an article, you know, is an interesting concept. Because those words in that form, basement dwellers, I have found, have a greater depth and weight, and they represent you and champion you and betray you. Because they are the semantic virus that we are all constantly sickened by. So essentially what I'm trying to say is, you're so accountable for what you're saying to the person, because literally what you're saying is going to be pretty much printed that way.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm the type of person, you listen to this radio show, you hear me talk. Most of my sentences are kind of fragmentalized, you know, a little bit of a sentence run into another sentence because my thoughts move very quickly. So sometimes you may get the idea of what I'm trying to say, but I may confuse you with how I'm trying to say it.
Mm-hmm.
That's all right.
Oh, I know.
You know.
I know.
But when it's just your voice, rather, you know, the vocalization of an idea, you just have to be responsible for illustrating your thought.
Right.
Okay? Using, you know, semantic language, using mannerisms and gestures and words and language in order to get across, you know, it's communication. But when it's written down, sometimes those fractured sentences sound a little strange, especially when they're transferred and translated almost exactly that way. So when you read the article in the Providence Phoenix this week, you may notice some of my sentences, the structure of my sentence is a little weird. You may think that I'm a little Down syndrome-esque. And I'm here to tell you for the first time that, yes, in fact, I have Corky fever. I don't know if I've ever told anybody that.
Oh.
Yes.
What is Corky fever?
Fight the power! You gotta fight the power, not me! So anyway, So it's in the Providence Phoenix. I just wanted to send a little shout out to Bob Gula out there, and you should all read his column all the time, because I said to him during that interview and on the phone that I applauded him because he's one of the few guys that takes the local scene, especially here in Providence, which, you know, there's a lot of talent in this area, but there isn't a lot of glue. There isn't a lot of cohesiveness. There isn't a lot of organization with that talent. There's a lot of kind of splinter talent floating around. Bob Gould is trying to unify a lot of that, and I applaud that, because I'm the type of person who's trying to unify a lot of things myself. So when I see somebody else, you know, catering to their own passion and trying to unify groups of people who have something to say, something to provide to the community, I find that to be applaudable, essentially.
I agree. Okay? I agree.
That's what I wanted to say. So yeah, you know, that's the coolest thing. I read that article, I was impressed. And half of me was impressed in a vain, egocentric, megalomaniacal way. Half of me felt like it was cool to get, you know, maybe people are listening to this show right now that never heard the show because they read this article.
I agree.
Right?
Yes. It was too quiet.
What'd you put in there?
I'm sorry, it was too quiet. I needed a little background music.
But it's funny that you put the background music.
I know.
Last week you yelled at me over this.
I thought we were doing it too much, and now I'm sitting here going, it's just too quiet.
Turn it up. I want to hear it.
Basement dwellers! Your king has been awakened once again! Damn you! This music brings out an evil, malignant, malevolent force within the depths of my soul that craves power and craves influence and sharpens my claws of manipulative struggle! Oh, yes! Yes! Louder! Louder, you sycophants! Louder! Riding my coattails, I bring ideas to the table you down one week, the next week you cannot live without! Why are you not a good representation for the people who listen to this show? Worthless slaves! Who cater to my every word, my every thought, my every goddamn emotion! Yes, welcome to the theater of ego! No positive radio.
Okay, just leave it. That was good. I need a drink. See, with this type of music, I was in the car not 7 or 8 hours ago with Larry D today. And I said, whenever I hear this kind of choral, powerful, choral-sounding music, this thing awakens inside of me. This, what I like to call, you know, I said it already, but kind of a malignant, malevolent kind of feeling inside of me.
I think a lot comes from, watching a lot of movies that have a lot of actions associated with swells of music. That's all in our orchestration, and we are definitely big movie guys. So.
I think you're right, and I also think that there's the idea that certain feelings are kind of, it can contaminate your consciousness, and once you get a taste of those feelings, you know, when you're reminded of those feelings, it's very powerful and very evocative. And this type of music evokes a very particular personality trait. And ladies and gentlemen, you know, if you've listened to this show for any length of time, you may have noticed that I have an extremely fractured persona. I mean, hold on.
That's an understatement right there. Mm.
I'm the first to admit it, that I think that deep down inside, and maybe not even deep down inside, maybe written all over the surface of my skin, I have a multi-layered system of psychological confusion, problematic
literally on
nature.
Your skin, if you look at your skin with the tattoos, you can see.
It's like multiple personalities.
You go from one weird thing to from fairies to guys that are on fire.
Arm likes the Cringe. This arm is a Japanese warlord. My leg likes Vikings. Look at my other leg. It's the sun and Jerry Garcia's initials. Was I friggin' queer when I put Jerry Garcia's initials on my leg when I was 19 years old? The answer, ladies and gentlemen, is yes. I was king of the elves when I was 19 years old. Now I'm king of the Jews and I'm 27 years old.
Veins are popping out of your head.
Listen,
left and right while you're yelling.
There was Jesus, and then there was King Arthur.
Yes, I love when you start talking about this stuff.
The second incarnation. I believe that there's a really weird thing going on in my brain. I believe that I'm privy to a certain degree of information that other people, I would say maybe no one else is privy to, and that is the fact that I believe, and I mean this seriously, I very well could be the third incarnation of Jesus Christ. And I shouldn't even say Jesus Christ,
the Spirit.
The Holy Triumvirate, the Holy Spirit.
There was come Jesus, in many forms.
Jesus betrayed by Judas.
Yes.
I don't know, what, like 1,100 years later.
Right.
There was King Arthur.
Betrayed by
Lancelot. Searching for the Holy Grail, the chalice that contained the blood of his former incarnation.
Right, yeah, good point.
Now we're almost, 1,000 years later?
Yeah.
And don't you think we'd be due for a third visitation of holy power and terror?
Why not Paul Hullabaloo?
And I believe
or Hullabaloo.
I'll tell you what, ladies and gentlemen, the story goes a little something like this. I was having varicose veins removed from my testicle, and for the second time, and I was having the surgery done.
Wow.
And I awoke from the surgery, and the surgery, it wasn't that it was botched, but what actually happened was that it ended up being a much more complicated surgery than the urologist who was performing it had assumed it was going to be.
Right.
So they ended up having to remove a great deal of varicose veins. It was strangling my testicles. So they were telling me, look, you're 18 years old. You have to have a major surgery or you may not ever be able to have children.
Yeah.
They said to me, literally, at this point, you are sterile. You can ejaculate, but you're sterile.
You're in a perfect position, though, for a kid your age at that time.
You're 18, and what's the last thing in life you want to hear? That we have to operate on your private spots. Yeah. It was really weird. Yeah. But actually, they operated on my abdomen, which was nice. They didn't have to touch me, but when I woke up, I had, like, this crystallized vision in my brain that I was supposed to rewrite the Bible. That the Old and New Testament needed to be, you know, the Bible needed to be thrown out. It all needed to go. It was antiquated and outdated, and I had thoughts inside of my brain that weren't there before I went into my anesthesia. When I woke up, I had a word in my head, and that word was Ironicon. And the Ironicon I started to write as a manifesto, the Bible, the word of Paul, the word of me, the religion of ego, the religion of selfishness, the evolution of all things. Religion not as a community thing, religion as an independent thing. Religion in general, forget that word. Let's throw the word away. The word is an anchor. The word is diseased and cursed. I'm in the process of creating something new. I'm in the process of building an army, goddammit. And this very weekend, last night, at approximately 10 p.m., I christened a new minister, I wanted to say right now.
Oh, yes. Yes.
And I'm going to say it over the air. I christened, of course, Mr. Bremstyle, the high roller, Jay Brem, as my minister of transportation and velocity. Music up! It was supposed to actually be a triumph. Let's wait, do it again. Ready? Do it again. I'm going to do it again. No, do it again. I want to do it again. It had to be triumphant.
Music. I got to get the music
No,
ready.
But it had to be triumphant. I just screwed my cue up. Time and space just... Jay Brem! Minister of Transportation and Velocity! Come on, music, come on. Yes, louder, more. Suck it up, music, give it to me. Break my neck, music. Yes. I named a new minister to go along with, of course, my minister of all that is electronically motivated, who is, of course, Dirty John Winterbottom.
Yes, sir.
My minister of machinery, metal, and objective thought, of course, the smoking man.
Yes, sir.
My minister of interior intellect, Mr. Christopher Raymond Nicini, who I decided to give ministership to.
Wow.
I've decided he is deserving of ministership.
What is his title again?
The Minister of Interior... The Minister of the Intellectual Interior. Excuse me, I screwed it up when
Can
I said it.
Can you define exactly what that means?
It is what it is. To define it would take energy away from it.
What's his role in the army?
That he's one of the inner circle.
Okay.
He's returned to his position in my inner circle. We had some problems, my friend Chris Nicini and I, for a while. I feel that those problems have been successfully ironed out, and I welcome him with open arms back to my inner circle, as I'm sure he has welcomed me into his. See, I'm not so vain and egocentric to think that this is only one inner circle. I'm a member of your inner circle, Dirty John, just as you are a member of mine. Mm-hmm. You are the king of your inner circle.
But they're not the same circles.
Well, no, but there are concurrent points.
Overlap. Exactly.
That's what's important.
There are small ellipses within each of these circles.
Right. Even though an ellipsis is a span of time.
No. There's another form of
ellipses.
Circles.
Oh, ellipses. I see what you're saying. Yeah.
Ellipses. I don't know what you want to call it.
Just lips.
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 There's a few
kissing.
Lips.
Kissing. It means kissing. To kiss.
To kiss.
To kiss a black girl and not tell your parents. That's what it basically means.
Really?
I didn't know that.
I don't
know. That's what I heard.
No.
So, and I think to myself, 10 years from now, it's going to be amazing. Of course, my minister of rhythm, the Miracle yes. Mark Wilcox.
Of course.
Which will be the greatest thing in the army that I want to build. Our army, an army of basement dwellers. Why will it be amazing? Because when we ride in to conquer a landmass, I will have a giant platform being dragged by 300 horses, and up top of that platform will be Mark Wilcox, the Minister of Rhythm, at a drum kit, playing the heaviest John Bonham tree stump drumstick drums to rile people up out of their beds. Arise, awaken, your new king has arrived. Bow before me. Bow before my punk army. I love it. Does it sound like I'm belittling my own ideas sometimes? Because I feel like it does. I don't know, though. I don't want to know. You know, I'm sick of it. What time is it?
It's about 20 past. I wanted to talk about something really quick.
Hit me with it.
I think we mentioned it before. On October 19th, we have the Union Station Blues Fest is going on in Attleboro, Massachusetts, and it's going to be a great, great little concert set in an old like theater.
Four great blues bands.
Great, great blues bands, emceed by Mr. Paul Hullabaloo.
I'm hosting it.
So you're gonna get your money's worth right there.
And one of the bands, of course, they've made two appearances on our show playing live, one on the AM show and one on this 90.3 frequency.
Right.
The Wild Blue Angels, the Electric Blue Flames, they're called when they do their blues. Yeah. And it's amazing.
And they have a whole new lineup, by the way.
Really?
They have a keyboard player that they've added to
the
blues setup.
You could check out that new lineup. Go to nopositiveradio.fanspace.com and check out that information.
We have a link. And on an upcoming show, you know, stay tuned because we're going to be giving away couple tickets to it, you know. I mean, they're like
$17 tickets.
Exactly.
Too.
So, you know, and then we're gonna give two or three of them. I don't know, and we're gonna give those away with some sort of contest or something. So, listen up for that.
Let's talk for a moment now, while we're promoting,
sure,
and selling it. Okay. While we're selling it,
okay.
While we are condensing our thoughts and actions into sellable products and talking about them on the air.
Okay.
Let's continue that.
Okay.
If you want, there's a brand new compilation from our radio show. Basically, a lot of stuff that we've done here, 90.3 WRU. Mm-hmm. I'm calling it the Black X Tapes, and it's now available. We're going to play a track from the Black X Tapes in a second. It's got like 10 tracks on it, 10 selections that I've gone through personally and found 10 selections that I think adequately represent what we've done thus far here at 90.3 FM. Under the beautiful administration here at 90.3, JP and Ryan Gomersall and Jackie Palumbo and all the rest of them.
Yes.
Wonderfully supportive, as you'll read in
Bill
the Phoenix
Parker.
Article. Bill Parker, of course. Larry D., who's my friend.
And he's actually...
Nicole Kieros.
Dean of the college.
Dean. Larry D., what's his title? I didn't say what minister he is. He's above a minister. Larry D. is the right hand of God.
Mm-hmm.
Period. Filthy John Monez, the left hand.
So which one gets to jerk you off?
That's who's ever bouncing on my knee. I don't know. And you're going to hear about it. I mentioned that in my thing, my little clip.
Okay,
I mentioned it in the clip. Funny that I should foreshadow.
Continue selling.
So people are like, well, what? You know, Larry D asked me, what does the Black X means? And what does the Black X tapes mean?
Right.
And I said, oh, that's an interesting that you bring that up. It's interesting. If any, I'm sure some of you out there, maybe most of you have heard of who Peter Tosh is. Of course, he was part of the Wailers.
Yeah.
Interesting story about him. Peter Tosh knew that there was political pressure on him, so he started to secretly record his life story onto audio tape, little microphone, little four-track, you know, tape recorder type deal. Recorded his stories, his theories about this vast conspiracy that was working against him, and he hid these tapes. These tapes were found after he was killed, and they were christened the Red X Tapes. Mm-hmm. There's actually a great documentary you can get at Acme Video on Brook Street in Providence called Stepping Razor Red X, about this whole idea of Peter Tosh recording these tapes. So, my homage, my respect for Peter Tosh, I decided to name this compilation the Black X Tapes.
There you go.
I couldn't call it the Red X Tapes.
No, no.
Because then people would think
was
Peter Tosh.
That'd be weird.
And of course, I'm not Peter Tosh.
Well, not last time I checked.
No, I'm not. Trust me. I'm basically not the reincarnation of Peter Tosh, but basically the reincarnation of King Arthur. We already went over that.
Yes.
Remember?
Yes.
So let's play a clip.
But while we're talking about the things available on the website, we also put up on there the hour-long documentary, The Cringe Full Exposure.
Oh, yeah, the documentary, of
Now,
course.
The deal with this is a documentary film by the great filmmaker Ray Daniels,
of course. He's been on the show before.
Yep, and we had this movie in, speaking of Acme Video, they carry it for us. You can rent it there, and it used to show on public access and all that. And we got a pretty good response. But we unfortunately do have to charge for this because of the cost in duplicating it. It's not like making a
Did you just hear my voice suddenly?
Your microphone turned on.
The wire just clicked. Weird. Okay.
So anyway, continue your thought.
So the cost to produce a videotape is a lot more than making a tape or a CD. So if we get enough pre-orders for this, then we're going to go out and have a whole bunch of these made, and you'll be able to get a copy of the movie through us. So if you look online, pretty soon you'll be able to tell us if you want to get a copy or not. And that determines whether or not we actually make it available.
Do you know what it's like to wake up every single morning feeling like a completely different person? Isn't that bizarre? Some people might think that would be an exciting life to lead, where every day you are literally somebody else. But ladies and gentlemen, I have to reiterate to you, I don't think you have, I think you have a limited understanding of exactly how fractured and jagged my identity and my personality has become. And yeah. I think that's a construct of my own willingness to fracture my personality. I've allowed it to happen, and now I have to sleep in bed with it every night. I don't know who I am. Who am I?
What brought this on? I thought we were going to a clip.
Let's do the clip. And ladies and gentlemen, this clip is great. This clip is a song that we did here. One of my favorite it's all improvisational. Improvisational punk folk song. It's called All Ye of Fatdick, and then parentheses, Need Not Apply.
Correct.
And I don't know. I think it's my pay into organized religion. And it's funny that I started this show talking about religion. Funny.
Weird.
But I didn't do it consciously. So, no. It's just, I'm such a magical master of magicery. So anyway, All Ye of Fatdick, parentheses, Need Not Apply, closed parentheses, Dirty John Winterbottom on the axe, Paul Hullabaloo, Minister of Propaganda, on vocalizations. And when we come back, you know what I'm going to do? We're going to talk more about, basically me!
Surprise, surprise.
Okay, let's play the song. We'll be right back. No positive radio. Turn the dial. And I'll rape you. This song, it's a brand new song, like I said. It's called All Ye of Fatdick, Need Not Apply. It's a little progressive ballad. A ballad of old, of yonder, of times past, of yore. So have you, what have you, who have you, will I have you? Maybe, if you like the song, and if you donate. All Ye of Fatdick, Dirty John on the guitar, Paul Hullabaloo on lyrics and verbiage and vocalizations. Here we go. Here we go. Ready? Taste it. You were a well of secrets. Most of them are true. They only wanted one thing, and that thing was not you, you, you. Like slaves in the fields, looking angry, picking cotton, cotton, cotton. Ah! Eggs by the dozen that you bought and brought home, rotten. Oh, ah! Change. All ye of Fatdick need not apply. All ye of Fatdick, raise your hands to the sky. All ye of Fatdick, pray loudly towards the Lord. All ye of Fatdick, join the Holy Roman Horde. Horde, horde, dreams and visions of high wire acts. Piles of douchebags stuffed into hot, wet sacks. Slaves in the fields looking angry, picking cotton, cotton, cotton. Or eggs by the dozen that you bought and brought home, rotten, rotten. Oh no! Change. All ye of Fatdick need not apply. Raise your hands to the sky. Ah! Yes. All ye of Fatdick, pray loudly towards the Lord, Lord, Lord. All ye of Fatdick.
Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. Father, forgive them, they don't believe that I'm the king of the Jews. Oh no. Ah, crucify me! Crucify me! I'm only asking you to nail me to the tree. Ah, oh, crucify me! Father, Father, crucify me! Change! All ye of Fatdick need not supply. Raise your hands to the sky, high, high. All ye affected, pray loudly towards the Lord. The Lord believes in your cause, don't you believe in his? All ye affected, join the Holy Roman Horde and crucify me! And crucify me! You slut! You whore! You beggar! You want more? I have nothing more to give you! Look into my eyes. Can't you see the fire of my own demise? Yes? No? Maybe? Check one of the boxes. I cannot outfox you. I will not deceive you. I did not conceive of the interest that you brought to me. I will not give birth to myself, for that would be mathematically impossible. Don't you believe me? Would a man like me lie? Would I lie? I have been crucified. I have been nailed to the tree with three rusty nails. Oh, God, 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 you don't know what you do to me, Lord. Oh, bring it down, soft. Bring it down. I want a sip of my drink while I get ready for this. Oh, yeah. Oh, Jesus, get down on your knees and pray to me, Paul Hullabaloo. I am your Lord. You may have the rest of them. I only want your prayers. Jesus, watch me unzip my jeans. Jesus, watch me remove my gi, my karate gi. I'm going to execute an all-important move on your chopsticks. What the Christ does that mean? I don't need to make sense. I am the Lord of Jesus. I am the Lord of the Lord of God. I sit not only on the right hand, not only on the left hand, not only on the beautifully bouncing knee of God above, but God prays. When God prays, I should say, when God prays, he prays to me! Go! All ye of Fatdick need not apply. Apply? What? All ye of Fatdick, raise your hands to the sky. Sky, sky! Wow! Pray loudly towards the Lord. The Lord prays to me. Ah, ga, 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 ga. All ye of Fatdick, join the Holy Roman Horde. Horde, horde, horde. Oh yeah. All ye of Fatdick, Fatdick need not apply. Oh no. Oh no. Oh, mama, 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 I ain't gonna tell you anymore.
Thank you very much. That was hardcore right there. That was some playing. You know, it's counterproductive, though, to rock so hard, because then the people want to listen. They don't want to be on the telephone and miss out on a song like All Ye of Fatdick Need to Apply.
Yeah, correct.
What'd you guys think of the... What'd you think? What? Ah, should we? I wish we could recreate that little banter there, but I've already forgotten what we said.
I don't know.
It's hard to rock like that, and then people want to listen. And
you're correct.
Hiya, what?
Huh? Who's?
Click, and all then right. We start talking.
Yes. And this is what it sounds like.
It's what
here
like
we go. Ready?
I wish I could recreate what just happened there because then. No, I'll try right now. We can just go forever in a vortex of confusion.
So that is a clip off the Black X tapes.
You can order that for free. Free of cause, including. Free of cause, yes. What is that? That's me. I'm free of cause. Free of charge by simply emailing nopositive@AOL.com. Email me your thoughts, your mailing address. Dirty John and I will send that out. nopositive@AOL.com, which is also the email address if you want to get in touch with us for any goddamn reason.
Complaints? And if you ask, Paul will send some naked pictures of himself in there, too.
I may
you
have.
You got a request.
I may have one. I don't know. From when I was a babe in swaddling clothes in my mother's arms.
How about
in a
that
manger?
Picture of Back to the Phoenix? Huh? We got a nice big old photo in there, too.
Yeah, 5x5, baby. That's feeding me
That's
right there.
Great,
I like it.
Huh?
You know who I miss? Can I tell you somebody I've decided I miss?
Who do you miss?
Remember Doe?
Doe?
Does anybody out there remember Doe?
Spelt which way?
D-O. Doe.
Doe.
How about the name Marshall Applewhite? How about the name Heaven's Gate Cult?
Oh.
Remember Doe?
No.
The white-haired
I don't know
prophet
what...
who said that there
oh,
was a
oh, yeah, yeah,
there
yeah,
was
yeah.
a spacecraft behind that comet that was
Doesn't,
going across.
Doesn't Miracle Mark have a picture of him on his fridge? That guy?
Yes. Okay. Doe.
Yes.
I miss Doe. First off, I think that was one of the most amazingly cool demonstrations of how television should be used. That extreme super close-up of his face. You know, they kept showing that footage of him talking to his flock. Yeah,
like
and
Big
saying,
Brother.
Essentially, yeah. But saying, listen to me, you know. There's a ship behind this comet. It's waiting for us to board. The only way to board is to actually leave this plane of existence by, I don't know, you know, what is it? Jim James. Is that his name? You know, Jim Jones.
Yeah.
Jim Jones. We're going to drink some poison Kool-Aid. And then we're going to take a trip up our souls into the ship. Get off the planet. Because pretty soon, this planet's going to end painfully. And there will be no ascension for the people who are left on the planet. So let's go. So that group of people, and I thought it was such a great poetic symbol that when they showed the news footage after they had all committed suicide in that compound, that they're all, it's crazy. They're all like wearing, they're all sheathed in those purple robes with Nikes sticking out.
Yeah.
I thought that was cool. I love that uniformity they all had. A cult of uniformity I thought was really kind of a poetic thing. You know, and it was kind of neat. I like the feeling of it. You know, I miss that. That's my thought on how television should evolve, how it should be used. I think every channel should essentially have one person on it all the time. One person who anchors that channel. And all you see is basically their face just overwhelms the entire television screen, and they're constantly speaking their mind, constantly telling you their thoughts, constantly trying to manipulate you, openly and out in the open. Listen to me. Openly and out in the open. Man, I am just I am a speaker of old. I'm an order not seen since frickin' Hitler, aren't I? You're all confused by my amazing intellect and thought here, aren't you? I said, what did I say? I don't remember what I said now.
Openly
and out in the open.
Yeah.
I'm fantastic. As a matter of fact, I'm fan-friggin-tastic.
See, you've gone so far off your point now, because you're getting sidetracked by confusing two words. We don't even know what you're talking about ahead of time.
Let's talk about the words genius and revolution for a second. Genius and revolution, what do they have in common, Dirty John Winterbottom? Those two separate words, what do they have in common as separate words?
Most revolutions are started by geniuses, or most revolutions produce geniuses?
Well, see, what you're doing now is you're doing what you just demonstrated something very interesting. How the human brain has to connect things together all the time. Everything always has to be connected.
You just asked me to connect those two words.
No, I said, what do they have in common? But then I specifically said,
which
as separate
is
entities.
A connection. Which means find a common
what
connection.
What do the two separate words have in common? Genius and revolution.
I just gave you my opinion.
Well, do you want my written down opinion?
Let's hear it. I know you're dying to give it
opinion.
To us.
My opinion, genius and revolution are two very important examples of words that have been overused. Words that have had their meanings raped and bargained away for coins that have long fallen out of current currency. Do you see what I'm saying? Genius and revolution to me have no meaning anymore. The word genius is used so often nowadays that to be called a genius now is like limiting and boring.
Yeah.
To have started a quote-unquote revolution now is trite, in my opinion. Okay? Everybody, I think one in five people, according to the way you hear the word used and thrown about, I think apparently one in every five people born is apparently a genius.
My
now.
Two-year-old daughter is a genius.
Basically anyone who can play guitar or add or write or get a handsome haircut is now a genius. You know, everybody, you know, Kurt Cobain's a goddamn genius, Jim Morrison's a genius, Albert Einstein's a genius. I would venture to say that you, Dirty John, are handsome.
Then you said handsome people are geniuses.
I got you excited. What?
You said handsome people are geniuses.
Funny how I keep tying my thoughts together subconsciously, isn't it? I want to talk a little bit about something, ladies and gentlemen.
Tell us your wisdom.
I want to wonder about something out loud. But first, okay, before I do it, let's see if anyone wants to call in, by
everyone
the way, share their
callers?
Thoughts. 792-9030. You're welcome to call in and join in on the discussion. Is that what we'll call this?
I want to hear from somebody who's read the article. I want to know what they think.
Well, that would be me. Wonder what I think? I read it.
Well, that's great.
Well, I thought it was great, and I thought Paul Hullabaloo sounded pretty amazing, like a genius. He's starting a revolution, I think. Hello.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, Pally.
How you doing?
What's up, Pally?
I'm going out of the Ocean Drive to smoke a big fat blunt right now, man. I thought I'd just call you up and let you know.
All right. Hey, light it up right now while we're on there. Let's hear it.
Light it up right now. All right, give me the blunt, man.
Oh, you're funny. Now, of course, you don't have a blunt.
They got it in the front seat, man. I'm going.
Not asking me for the blunt because I'm on the radio. I'm not real. I'm a frequency. I'm an electromagnetic signal. I can't pass you the blunt. Isn't it amazing that when I'm on the air, I'm literally everywhere within a certain range at all times?
Dude, that shit is a shit.
Listen to this guy.
You guys are the shit, man. See you later.
All right, bye-bye. This is what I like about No Positive Radio. We are such a forum for intellectual conversation. Sometimes it's mind-numbing.
But that was funny.
Let's take one more, then I'm going to talk. Yes.
Yes, gentlemen. I think it was the legal department that cut the Dirty John out of your article.
They didn't like dirty, huh?
Yeah, they were probably afraid that it was libelous.
Oh,
libelous?
But what's my name? To be called that?
I know, but they probably were just scared.
All right, thank you.
Thanks.
Yep, bye.
Bye.
Okay, who the hell is that?
Here's what I want to wonder about. Here's what I want to think about out loud in my brain. I want to externalize my internal quandary here. I have to wonder about things. Why am I? I wonder all the time why I feel so saturated with cynicism. That's what I want to know. You know, I don't have any reason to be as maligned and as cynical as I have become in life. You know, I look at it. What I am, I am the genesis of no positive, the no ideology of no positive. Everyone, people ask me, what's no positive? Are you suggesting there's no positive radio out there?
No, not at all.
I'm not suggesting that at all. I'm sure there are many underground shows out there that are actually very exciting and have passion behind them. So that's not what I'm suggesting. I say no positive to mean like HIV positive. No positive, like you are a no positive personality. You've been diagnosed no positive. You kissed somebody who was cynical, got their saliva in an open wound in your mouth, and you've become diagnosed no positive. You are born or at least bred cynical. However, here is the quandary, as I use that word for the second time. The quandary is I have absolutely no business being as cynical as I am. Ladies and gentlemen, I am essentially still sucking on the monetary teat of both of my parents. I am from a household of the most rampantly unadulterated, unconditional love that the world has ever seen.
I can attest to that, yes.
My parents have coddled me since day one. My mother is, first off, my mother is an extremely talented artist.
Yes.
And a very interesting and unique, kind of eccentric personality.
A little bit.
Interesting.
Yeah, she is literally, or should I say, was, back in the day, a hippie girl. Like she was that, you know what I mean? But not only
ran with the peace and love mongers.
Yes, but to the extreme, to the point where she was meeting the people who are making the things happen. Bob Dylan, Janis Joplin, Santana. I mean, she knew these people.
She was a portrait artist. Essentially, she painted Carlos Santana for Carlos Santana, painted Janis Joplin for Janis Joplin. Interesting quick story. I love this. This is a great story, real quick.
Yeah.
My mother painted Janis Joplin. My mother went to meet with Janis Joplin, hung out with the holding company Janis Joplin, presented this portrait, this beautiful oil painting of Janis Joplin. Janis Joplin had just received a tattoo on her arm, like a jailhouse-looking tattoo of a heart.
Yeah.
So Janis Joplin asked if she could paint the heart on the arm in the of her arm in the painting.
That's cool.
My mother gave the painting to some flim-flam boyfriend she had at the time. And it's gone forever. Weird, sad.
Jeez. I bet you could find it out there somewhere.
My mom said it's one of the great regrets of her life.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, I come from a household of astute affluence. I can't even begin to tell you. You know, and I don't know why I feel this way, why I feel such a sense of malcontent, I should say. I was going to say discontent. Something's shaky about that word. I'm going to use malcontent, which I've heard used before. Of course, with my flawed instincts, it's probably malcontent that doesn't make sense and discontent what I should have used. Bill? What do you think? He said go with what I'm comfortable with. I'll say malcontent. I could be wrong. You know... And I see myself as a example of what I'm trying to propagate here as a resistance. A resistance born of not needing any resistance. Are you seeing what I'm saying? I think my goal and my dream in life is to conquer the hearts and minds of a horde of people that were born without hearts and minds. Is that so much to ask? Aaron, it is a pleasure to see you again. How are you? Kind sounds coming up shortly. Boy, does this goddamn hour go by fast.
Wow.
Isn't it amazing?
Do you think you probably feel that way, though, because you never felt... the contentment you thought you should feel from coming from a family that had love and money and everything was okay, and but you still didn't feel the way you thought you should feel from all that?
I think that that's an interesting point, an interesting question to pose to me. And now let me, I throw it into my databanks, I let myself digest that for a second, and my spit-out answer would probably be a little of, I don't know if it's that... like a naturalized state of just not recognizing the blissful harmony that I am the product of.
Yeah.
Now, of course, you know, I didn't have perfect parents, all right? Yeah, my parents split up, got back together, are now split up again.
Yes.
I remember being a young kid and my dad, you know, being, I don't know, like 12 years old or 11, and my dad introducing to me some other woman, this very Jewish-looking woman with a fat ass.
Okay.
And I knew, I don't think that's my mother. That doesn't smell like the womb I fell out of. You know, so I was like, who is this? Why are you holding hands with this woman? So, of course, my father was never perfect. My father, for all his strange, you know... anger, you know, malnourished emotional center. For all that, he was always extreme and remains very supportive of me. You know what I mean? I'm still blissfully spending his money.
Yep.
They helped me out of more binds than I could tell you. I'm still essentially, but you are too.
Yeah, I know.
You have to be bankrolled a lot.
Well, I stopped when I was supposed to, but I've recently had to start, milking off my parents again.
What are you going to do, though, right? I'm sure there are more people.
It's good once in a while. It makes them feel useful in the world, you know?
Yeah, you're right.
What would your mother do if she felt like she couldn't be a mother to you and help you out of these situations? She'd go nuts. Your mom isn't one of those moms that lives to be a mom. That's what she does. Like, she's a mom. She takes care of her family. That's what she does.
That's what's so beautiful about my mother.
And she's perfectly happy and seems,
you're
or at
right.
least seems to be happy and loves doing it.
Well, I can tell you, I'm fairly good at quietly judging and reading things off of people. And I think my mother hides a lot, or she attempts to.
Yeah.
Things that I see that I would never let her know I see, but I see. I think there is a core of sadness that exists within my mother somewhere.
Yeah.
And I look at that and I say, maybe that's kind of what has sprung into my soul here a little bit. But you know what, I boil it down and I think I was naturally born what I call a punk. Somebody who no matter what they'll receive in life, no matter what they've been given, opportunities, etc., I will always feel a sense of disquieted feeling.
Okay.
I don't know if I wonder sometimes, honestly, if I will ever feel truly comfortable in life. Trust me, I look at what we're doing. Here we are on the radio right now. This,
yeah.
To me, ladies and gentlemen, I've said it, I'll say it always, I pray to this. This is spiritual to me, being on the airwaves. This is really real to me, one of the most real and tangible things ever. I am literally obsessed with what we're doing here on the radio. Ladies and gentlemen, I think it, like I said, it boils down that I really believe that I am a punk. And it's time for people to unlearn the idea, the thought of what a punk is. And I've been rallying about this over and over. Why? Because I'm trying to build an army. Most people don't take that seriously. But 10 years from now, when I'm conquering land masses, it's going to be the funniest thing on earth. And I will have the goddamn last laugh. Ladies and gentlemen, what is punk to me? I can break it down very simply right here now. Punk is a natural persona state that derives itself from a person's organic internal obtuseness, okay? Mixed with a spiritual vacancy and an acute and unembarrassed malignant disposition. I say that out loud, my thoughts, and I'm going to tell you what, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to tell you what. I'm currently writing a draft of the first part of a giant manifesto. I look at myself kind of like the electromagnetic Unabomber. I'm creating a manifesto. I'm writing down my thoughts, my feeling on the sway of all things. How I fit in. Why? Because I can't write about how you fit in, or how Bill fits in, or even how Dirty John fits in. Certainly, last but certainly not least, how Aaron fits in. I don't know. I can only write how I fit in on the grand scheme of things. And guess what? I don't really fit in. Neither do you. Neither does Dirty John. Neither does Aaron. Neither does Bill Parker. Neither do any of you basement dwellers out there listening. That's the rub of it all. Okay? We're all connected by being disconnected. See what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Trust me, I'm perversely interested in the idea of this. I'm perversely interested in television, in the media. I am perversely interested in the idea that we are a part of the mass media. This evil, you know, growing creature. We are feeding it. Even by trying to bring something good, something no positive out of it. We're feeding into it. And I think we are corrupting more than we are helping just by being on the air. But God bless the magic of that. See what I'm saying? There is a violence in just sitting here and just talking on the microphones. There is a violence to that. This is blood and guts spilled out on a highway right here, coming out of my mouth and your mouth right now. Even if I was to say, we spent 60 minutes back and forth doing this, right? I love you.
I love you.
No, I love you.
No, I love you.
I love you.
I don't love you.
I love you.
It's really starting not to like you
that
much.
I like your sweater.
Right.
You have a very handsome sweater. Dude, is that tweed? No, that was Mark Wilcox. When I say tweed, his head just popped up. Huh? Hemp shirt, tweed pants? Somebody take it out of my closet?
Stop.
I'm sorry. I love Mark. He's my minister of rhythm. I love him. I like to give him the rub once in a while. Let me just tell you, ladies and gentlemen. I said it before. I'll say it again. I'm here to conquer the hearts and minds of those born without hearts and minds. I consider myself to be a dangerous man. Dangerous because I allow the quiet of my mind to rattle and roll around to come up with whatever it wants to come up with. If you could hear half of the thoughts that run through my brain daily, you would not want to listen to me on the radio right now. Because you would know underneath all the funny, cutesy, talkity wishwash, I think is a destructive and obtrusive force just waiting to break free. A whole other personality. And I graduate personalities.
Wait a minute. You say this like it's a new thing for you to have a new personality.
I'm Paul Hullabaloo now.
Yeah.
I don't know who I'm going to be maybe a year from now or 2 years from now. I could be somebody completely different. All right?
God help us all. God help us all.
I'm telling you, the funny thing is, eventually, I don't know what's going to happen. I may have to either fake my own death or go into hiding. Because I was born to cause some sort of trouble, whether it be vocal or very physical and dynamic. I haven't quite yet decided.
Well, I hope you get somebody else to do the physical part for you, because you ain't
at this point,
being
I
physical
feel,
with anything.
At this point,
I just said you ain't. I hate saying that.
Yeah, what is that?
That just slipped out. I don't really talk like that.
It makes you sound tough.
You ain't gonna be beating up nobody around these parts.
Quoth Elvis Presley, you ain't nothing but a hound dog crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog crying all the time. You ain't never caught a rabbit. And you ain't no friend of mine. End quoth.
I also hate when people use the word seen in the wrong context or the wrong way.
I don't know what you mean.
Well, somebody will say, have you seen Joe lately? You'll say, no. Or you'll say, yeah, I seen him at the store. No, I used it wrong.
How many people say use guys?
Use guys.
I feel literally that those people, I don't see a problem with having them murdered. You say use guys, you're on a black list in my book. You know what I'm saying? Everybody? Everyone with me? Isn't it funny when you're too lazy to change a roll of toilet paper and you actually use the last piece that has cardboard on it from the toilet paper roll? That's my pronouncement of laziness. I was on the toilet and I used that piece of toilet paper. Is that wrong? Is that laziness? What's wrong with me? That's what I call, what is that called? That's something that's humor. It's called a certain kind of humor. That's called observational humor. I just popped a little observational humor into the show right then and there. Right now, I bet Bob Gould is thinking, can I take back that article by any chance? Did it go to press yet? Because I'm quivering under my bed and crying. I don't know. I hope that you people follow me. I hope that you people love me. I just want to be loved. I just want something in the world. I just want to create something that's bigger than me. You see what I'm saying? I'm not ever going to be satisfied or comfortable in life. And I miss Marshall Applewhite. And genius and revolution are overused and
raped.
Do
you want to take the call?
Let's take a call. No positive.
Find me somebody to love. Hey, I read the puff piece in the Phoenix.
You son of a bitch. Why are you calling her a puff piece?
Who's this?
He calls in. It's James.
Oh, it's James. Okay.
That's not such a bad word, puff piece,
My favorite part is when he says that I'm never insulting.
I never want to insult you.
I don't think I really insult anybody. I know Dirty John had a laugh over that line in the article. He's like, what do you mean never insulting? I'm like, don't cross me! I'll bury you in my neighbor's basement! And he cried and hidden under a bed, and we all had to coddle him for 5 hours. It was really tragic and fun at the same time.
When's the Cringe playing again?
We do Cringe shows every so often on purpose. We don't want to oversaturate the market with that.
We're working on one very soon, though. Soon.
We're working on it. We're recording, too, so. Working on an album. I call the album at this point Pathos of Glory. I think it represents what we're trying to put on tape. You say on tape, but that's not even what we're doing. We're recording onto a computer. Now it's all digital.
Yeah.
What a sellout. We don't even record on tape. We have no business. Thank you.
Okay.
Bye.
Good night.
792-9030. Call up and criticize me or something. I don't know. There's somebody. Give me the business. No positive.
Okay.
That was fantastic. This the swell of intelligent thought here is magnificent. Yes.
Hello.
Hi.
Hey, I love you, man.
I love you too.
I wanted to say that, and also, how you always used to talk about your girlfriend.
The beautiful Blake Hines.
Blake. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I recently had an experience like that. I don't know really much about your relationship, but I was with this girl for a while, and I was just wondering your opinion about it. Just all of a sudden, she just, fell out of love with me, I guess, and I don't really know what the problem was.
That's all I need to hear. Can I tell you what my thought is on it? I have a very simple idea, very simple thought when it comes to that, because I've had to go through it and I've had to rationalize it. My advice to you is romanticize that pain. Romanticize that hurt. Look at yourself outside of yourself. Imagine that you are a character in a great epic novel, and this happened to you. Well, what would that character in that novel do to progress the story? What would the character do? The character would use that to recreate himself as a more powerful and efficient being. Love that pain. Love it. Fall in love with that. Fall in love with somebody falling out of love with you. And you'll be healthier than you ever were. Do you see what I'm saying?
You know what? That would help me cope with the pain, but the problem is that it was just so sudden and so, it seemed to me so unnecessary, but the girl won't even call me,
Why would you want... What do you want? You want to rub your face in the... What are you, a puppy needs your face rubbed and you peed in the house? Come on.
No.
Why are you calling her? Where's the spine? Where's the backbone? How old are you?
I just want some respect, you know what I mean?
Well, asking her to call you and whimpering is not going to get you any respect.
I'm 21.
My friend, what you have to do is this. You have to have a evil grin on your face and realize that your respect is not going to come from anybody else. And it's cliche to say, but it's true. You're the only person who's ever going to provide a well of respect for yourself. You may think other people are respecting yourself, but the only thing you're really feeling is your interpretation of their sensibility towards you. Do you respect yourself? Truthfully.
I respect myself a lot, yeah.
Do you do something in this world that's meaningful? That do you feel connected to something? Or are you a waste of time? Be honest.
Lately I haven't felt very connected to anything at all.
Wow.
I don't know. But don't you have the same feeling sometimes, though? I mean, I hear you talk about it.
Man, I go through the gamut. I feel everything all the time. Trust me, it's easy for me to sit here and tell you how to feel, because I've already, disengaged myself from feeling anything about the beautiful Blake Hines. It took me about 14 days. But now I've cursed myself, and I feel like I can't, even if I try, feel anything for the beautiful Blake Hines. But I can remember that version of myself and remember the sense of overwhelming tragedy I felt. And longing, not so much, and this is only my feeling, not so much for losing her as a human being, but for losing the idea of her. That's what was painful to me.
Yeah, well, it's been about 14 days for me, actually. That's kind of weird you say that, but I don't know. I guess with the only thing that's going to help is time. And
be patient. Maybe, you must be patient, right?
And loving the pain, like you tell me.
That's all you got to do.
I'll embrace the pain.
Romanticize it, and don't do it in some medieval faggot sense. I'm talking about romanticize the feeling that you feel. Look at it. Learn to look at yourself outside of yourself. Learn to imagine yourself as somebody else. See what I'm saying? Trust me. Try it.
All right.
Study that.
Hey,
what's your name?
Thanks, man.
What's
You're doing a great job. My name's Pete.
All right, Pete. I appreciate you and your call and your thoughts.
Hey, man, I'm going to listen as long as you're on.
Thank you, brother.
The other person hung up.
That's all we got time for, anyway. Until next week, I want you to check out the website, nopositiveradio.fanspace.com. I want you to listen to Kind Sounds with Aaron. I want you to listen to the kids' show with Bill.
Yeah, take a few minutes after we're done to just sort of relax, let that digest, and listen to some good music, you know?
I just want you to know that no matter what happens, no matter where I end up, and no matter who I become, which may not always be me, I will secretly always love and respect you. There you go, Pete. There's your respect. If you need to get it from somebody else, I respect you. And I also want to say really quick, met a young punk named Phil this weekend who might be listening right now.
If Phil's listening,
Phil's joining the army. 14 years old. Full of punk thoughts. God bless him. And the right kind of punk thoughts, not the cliche. Amen. So until next week, if you want to email me, nopositive@AOL.com, this is Paul Hullabaloo and
Dirty John Winterbottom
asking you kindly to subject, oppose, subvert, and always live the lie. Be good.